me if I make mistakes either way. And as far as music is concerned, I'm only a listener. So my most of the perspectives that I have are primarily from a listener's point of view. I'm most interested in the signal processing aspects of music, the reason why I got quite excited about this particular task. And I'm just going to give you a Team Krishna will talk a lot about this, but just to give you an idea of this kind of the outline that I have talked about, I must say our interest at least is to look at how Carnatic music can be, as already he talked about, put it, can be search based on phrases. That's one of the important things that I'd look at. And then we started also realizing that after lots of discussions over the December season that a Carnatic music concert in itself, from a listener's perspective, is, you know, it's a very different thing, compared, at least in my opinion, it's quite different from Hindustani music for that matter. And Carnatic music is actually has the most unique feature is the is replete with gamakas, and this is something that we would like to look at. So one of the serious things that we are looking at is how do I characterize gamakas in Carnatic music, and how do you process Carnatic music using motifs? First thing that we are looking at is we want to do source separation, vocal and accompanying instrument, and so on and so forth, or instrument and accompanying instruments. We are looking at time frequency motifs for this, and motifs for gamakas, are they there? And motifs for ragas in terms of, because the intonation and energy together, I feel, constitute a gamaka. And that's something raga define in terms of these motifs. That's what we would like to look at. So to just give you a very brief outline, this is a listener's perspective, so pardon me if I'm making any mistakes here. Concert is essentially made up of a sequence of pieces, and the pieces correspond to different forms. In Carnatic music, you have varnam, you have kriti, you have the tillanas, you have the javali, so on and so forth, and there is some kind of a sequencing of these pieces, and each form has a very specific characteristic, both in terms of rhythm and also in terms of the way it is, the way the lyrics are formed. And generally melodies, as we call ragas, are seldom repeated except in a thematic concert. I have heard some thematic concerts, the Bhairavi concert will have a varnam in Bhairavi, a kriti in Bhairavi, and everything in Bhairavi for that matter. And in a concert, you generally find that one or two pieces are elaborated in great detail, and a kriti will consist of an, and that's what this is, the, this is what I feel, just like you have in the Hindustani, different parts of a khayal for that matter. In much the same way, kriti has an alap, a composition made of a pallavi and a pallavi charanam. And there is some improvisation around the nerval, and a swara prastara is essentially enunciating the notes, but with a lot of gamaka, and there's a solo component. And RTP is somewhat like the khayal, I would say, in Hindustani. There's an ala patanam, a composition, which is primarily a pallavi. And generally in RTP, we'll see, just like a kriti will have these things, and in addition, the rhythm cycles can be quite complex. And what is, for me, very different about a Carnatic music concert is that every concert by the same musician, in the same season, you attend five concerts by the same musician, it, I feel it tells me a different story from a listener's perspective. And that's something I feel there is an, as I think Sarah was the one who pointed this out to me when we went to a few concerts by the same people. And then this is something which is very exciting about Carnatic music. And to just give you an idea of the written forms that are in terms of Arohana and Avarohana, what you learn when you go to the first school class that you go to, starting from sequence of notes in ascending order, sequence of notes in descending order. Of course, we don't, we just have some places that are there. And the vocal or instrumental form of a raga is replete with gamakas. Although there are specific placeholders as defined by the notes, which is, I mean, nowadays there are written forms that are coming into the picture, but seldom is the note uttered and the note sung have a exact one-to-one correspondence. And I think at least whatever I've read, Carnatic music is primarily made for the vocal tradition. And classification of gamakas, there are some things that my student now, Vignesh, who's also a musician, has taught us quite a bit. And we also looked at Subrahmanya Dikshitar's book. And there's supposed to be a finite number of meandering patterns that are observed. The Kampitam, Jaru, Vali, Spuritam, Murikai, Udikal, so many of them. And the gamakas are supposed to be stitched together or overlaid with the other. Other than this, you have significant usage of brikas, where essentially go up and come down the scale. And over, more importantly, what we have seen is there's a standard set of melodic phrases that are observed in every piece. I'm primarily talking from a signal processing perspective. So one of the things that we started looking at first was how good are signal processing algorithms as actually extracting gamakas. If I take an alap, does it extract it correctly when I put it back? That is the first thing that we tried to look at. I mean, primarily from the Carnatic music point of view. So we extracted the pitch contours, and I must tell you, this is some algorithms that we have developed locally in our lab. And I must say that we did not do this. We did not put a complex tone. We just put the pitch pulses back, took the vocal track parameters in terms of linear prediction coefficients, and simply synthesized it back. So bear with me. This is not going to sound very nice, but this is a KVN alap, which I have. KVN Narayan Swami is one of the renowned singers of Carnatic music. He died a few years ago. This is the original KVN alap. So this is what the original sounds like, and here is what the I think I need the volume up. Oh, I didn't open it. Continue. Not connected to internet. Okay. So the important point to realize is that the pitch extraction algorithms is extracting the gamakas well, because it's essentially following it. If you ignore the fact that the timbre of the voice is lost completely, the pitch is, you can, in fact, it's interesting that I think Vignesh was my first guinea pig, and I just played him the synthesized version, and I said, can you find out the raga from this? And he identified it as Shankaravarnam. So he said, okay, it is doing a reasonable good job, it's not messing up too much. So this, so we at least, you know, we are. And we experimented with a very large number of pitch extraction algorithms, and almost all algorithms seem to extract the pitch very well. Then the whole idea is, if you can get these pitch contours, how do we model these pitch contours? Can we use it for segmentation, phrase ID? I also would like to do singing voice identification and archival, as Preeti Rao already talked about. And ultimately develop machine learning algorithms for various tasks. I mean, I'm also kind of do a lot of work on machine learning in various other kinds of tasks. So this is something that I feel we can benefit a lot from machine learning algorithms being applied to music. This is something that I would like to look at. And here are characteristic pitch and histograms of various gamakas as they are being quantified. Any problems? I think you have to catch Vignesh, because he is the one who sung this in. And this is what is called a kampitam. And this is the so a kampitam is one where it keeps oscillating between a pair of notes. It goes up, comes down, goes up, comes down. That's what you're seeing. For me, more interesting, I want you to look at the figure at the bottom there, which is the spectrogram. And if you look at it around this particular spot over here, to get this. Okay. Here, for example, if you look at this particular spot, this is a frequency histogram, and you notice that it has a very nice structure in the. So I feel it's not a simple pitch-based motive, it's a time frequency motive is what I feel, because this is a frequency axis and this is the time axis. And it's interesting that if you look at carefully the spectrograms, almost all the spectrograms of the various gamakas that we have seem to have a nice time frequency motive, and this is something that I feel we should kind of, I mean, I'll show you some results on that. Okay. All right. Maybe this is another one which is very nice, which is very obvious what's happening. And this is the jadu. So it's basically going from one note to the other. You go up, you come down, and again is coming down. And this is something that is also another kind of gamaka that is there, which is quite a lot used. But what we found, I mean, there are a whole lot of them. If anybody is interested, we can look at what is available. But, what we did was we asked Vignesh to use all these gamakas and make an alap. And here is an example of where we have marked everything. And so the names are given there. I know they. Kampitam. Charu, and there's a Udukalata. There's again a Kampitam. This is some arbitrary motif. So what we did was we made him sing a gamaka with all the sing an alap with all these gamakams used. The primary reason why we asked him the reason why we asked him to do this was we wanted, when we were looking at many of the alaps that were sung by musicians, we found that we are actually only finding it occasionally. It's not that it's very regularly used. I have another one here where we have looked at again Kavians by, Kavians by Revi Alap, which has these. So the colored ones are the, this is marked by, so all the gamakas are marked there, but there are, what we find is there are very large number of phrases in between and the gamakas are occasionally used. So we realize that perhaps, you know, maybe this is not the way we should primarily look at it. From a pedagogic point of view, perhaps gamakas are important for a learner of music or whatever it may be. But from a listener's perspective, one of the things that you're looking at is, if I'm given a, what is the motif which enables me to identify a raga immediately? You know? And maybe it's not, there's this finite set of gamakas which are there, but there are specific motifs for a raga. So what we started looking at is, and we also saw in the spectrogram that there is this beautiful variation on along the time and the frequency. So one of the things that we said is, maybe we should start looking at time frequency motifs, and time frequency marks are portions of significant activity, and that requires a lot of needs exploration. Another thing that we also started looking at is, do we really need to map it to this language as defined? As he was saying, this actually perhaps there's nothing like a specific language, and could we simply get signal processing motifs and use those signal processing motifs, put them in a machine learning algorithm and see what it learns? So
click on PPT and then next.
I think this is happening twice for me today. All right. I'm sorry, I have to reboot my machine. It happened to me for the second time. I just want to show a few times. The tunings paper which we had, which Sarah talked about some time back, then we did a little more work on looking at various alaps, and we repeated the same thing. And what is interesting is, I mean, there is this, you have a Re2 in Kalyani, and the same Re2 is also supposedly, the placeholder is there in Karagarapriya. And what we notice is, if you notice, the Re in Karagarapriya has a much larger histogram on the side. I'm sorry whether you can see this properly or not, maybe we should have. There is like the approximate placement of the Re over here, and the approximate placement of the Re over here. And if you notice, the reason, if you look at the Re in Kararapriya and the Ree in Kalyani over here. If you look at the histogram heights, they're quite different. So basically, is it possibly that the Ga is so close to Ree that the man meandering, I mean, I don't know what this is. Maybe it's not even the, we don't know whether it's the Ree or the Ga for that matter. I'm not sure whether that's, so these are some things that we have noticed. From Raga to Raga, it seems to differ quite a bit. And here's another one, Sri Ranjani and Hamsadvani. Again, the same thing that you see here. Ree and Ga very close here. Ree and Ga separated over here. So, you know, the Ga has a very small height over here as per the scale. I mean, this is the equitempered scale that we're talking about. And so this is something that is also, so it has to be the analysis, the tunings have to be based on the ragas, what we have kind of concluded. And so the summary of the histogram analysis is that, in fact, one of the things that we also did was we also built the histogram as we went along. And I don't know whether I should, I'm just worried this thing will crash when I play this. Anyway, so this is the, so basically the histogram is being built as the alap is being sung. It's not loud enough. And there is a red dot that's supposed to be moving around on the, I think we can't see it very clearly. I can see it on my machine over here. It moves from one note to the other and shows the building up of the histogram. So the reason why I want to talk about this is I feel, you know, we can look at this histogram as it progressively builds, and that itself could perhaps be used for as a language to build signal processing algorithms. That's about it. And then finally, of course, the time frequency representations, which I'm very excited about. These are based on what we call non-negative matrix factorization, for those of you who don't know what these are. Basically, let's say V is the sum piece or the Fourier transform, short time Fourier transform magnitude spectrum of the entire piece, then W and H are two matrices, and these two matrices are non-negative matrices. And most important point about this, this is all elements of the matrices must be greater than or equal to zero, and V is the short time Fourier transform magnitude spectrum. The original phase of the short time Fourier transform is what is used in recent SIS. And we did some work on trying to see if we can separate, we took a violin and a mridangam. So what we did was, so these are your F basis vectors, and these are essentially, what this W corresponds to is a short time Fourier transform spectrum, one slice, multiple slices. Whereas you take, let's say about 10 or 15 frames, and you take these time frequency slices, and these three time frequency slices is what forms your motif, and that's what we have been looking at. And we just learned this stuff about 2 or 3 weeks ago, and we decided to try it and got some results anyway. So these are, this is your W matrix, and this is your H matrix, and H activate these basis functions. I'll just give you an example of what it gives, what it picks up. So basically the idea is that you can determine these basis functions for each source alone. And then you, when you, once you have these basis functions and I have the entire music, I can project it along that particular mridangam or vocal or violin. And that's the utopic hope that we have. But right now, we will just, what I'll do is I will just show you all the stuff that we have done. So this is the violin and mridangam. Mm-hmm. And so let me open the mridangam. Thank you. There are mistakes, but let's open the violin. There are beats somewhere in the background, but it has suppressed it quite a bit. Okay. So this is sort of the latest that we have done, and I feel this is something which is really interesting in the sense that it's not simply the pitch contour. It's both a time and frequency motif that we are looking at, and that perhaps is what we should try and. We've also done a little bit with the gamakas of Vignesh, but I don't have any examples to play here. We've synthesized it using these time frequency motifs. So this is something that we can look at. So we've done it primarily for source separation right now, but it could also be used for maybe automatic segmentation of pieces, because once I have the basis functions, then I pass it through the pass the entire music through this, and it will give me the boundaries. And the suppression of percussion, we have not done it very well, but I think we could do better than what we are doing right now. So we could use it to maybe detect, distinguish gamakas, phrases, so on and so forth. So this is the current thinking that we are looking at in Carnatic music, and hopefully all these will become filters. And ultimately, the goal is that whatever we develop, we operate on this music, and that is taken ultimately to music brains. So you could filter based on a motif, and hopefully it will pick up, as you said, similar pieces, similar. Yeah. So thank you for your attention. Sorry for my mess with the machine, but I'm very new to Apple. It's supposed to be very easy, but I think it's not all that easy.